So this can be summed up pretty good tonight. A pastor called me this morning and said, hey. And then he gave me an assignment. He says, I want you to teach on trust. Okay, well, that's kind of cool. I had nothing. Now, usually, I know that I'm kind of the last minute guy. So I try to keep some notes in the background, but I ain't got no notes for this one. But trust. It's all about trust. And that's like, immediately he said, I said, okay. You see, I've told Pastor no one time in the past. I'm sure I've implied no many more times, but I've really said no once. And I felt so horrible about the whole thing. And God just worked with me on that. And he said, okay, Micah, and many of you have heard this before. God said, just preach what I give you. He says, he told me, he said, Micah, you've never had an original thought in your life. I said, okay. So this morning when I get the call, pastor says, I want you to teach on trust. I said, okay, trust. Well, what I've learned over time, one is we learn how to trust over time. And secondly, I trust him to bring something for y'all. So, like, if you don't get nothing, that's your fault. No, not really. So, but this whole evening, this whole teaching can be summed up in that hymn, trust and obey, for there's no other way. To be happy in Jesus. And what's the rest of it? But do trust and obey, yeah. So back when I started in earnest my faith walk, back in the big city of Middleburg, I mean down in the inner city, our church was in the inner city of Middleburg, I kind of got serious about my faith, and we sang all these old hymns, and they were killing me. Can I be honest? They were killing me. Killing me. So I thought, well, there's got to be something here to this stuff. So I put the effort in to start studying them. I started looking at them and reading what they said and found out about what the people that wrote those went through. And by the time I got to the end, I was like, these dudes are deep. Now, let me put this in perspective for you. Many of those old hymns were written back in the 1718, early 1900s. That is a time when the mortality rate for children was around 50%. Now, there's nothing greater in my life except for my wife and my kids. I love my babies. I love my wife. My family is so precious. I can't imagine. I mean, I had two. I can't imagine just losing one. I can't imagine what that's like. And these people, it was normal. And then they went through World War I. And then they went through World War II. And every family was touched by this. And then these people went through tragedy and trial, and they came up with these songs. I'm like, yeah, they got something. To trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. That's a short story. We could probably go home from that. But we can't. But I do want to do a little review. You know, Pastor's been talking about covenant, and he's been tearing it up. He has straight been tearing it up. And I want to do a little review. I went back through my notes and was reviewing some things, and there's some things that are very important about what's going to happen tonight. One of the most important ones was that slapped me in the face. Now when I say we, I mean me. I'll try to say me more often. But if it fits, you know, put the pants on, put the shirt on, it's all right if it fits. If it doesn't fit, go ahead and nod off. It's all right. But I'm so centered on myself that I thought all the promises and the covenant was all about me. I thought it was all about what God would do for me, what God could bless me with, what God could do. All these things was about me. And Pastor brought this great revelation that it was all about Jesus. I'm like, wow. You know, I've kind of glazed over it. I've kind of hit the edge of it. But the covenant is between God the Father and Jesus the Son. And the only reason that we get the benefit of those promises and the benefit of the glory of God in our life is because of our connection as a brother to Jesus. We get adopted. But the promises are for him. I'm just riding on the king's coattails. I'm just riding along in the background. I had no idea. I thought it was all about me. And I'm sure you guys, I'm sure your silence is saying, yeah, Micah, I thought it was all about you too, Micah. Obviously, it's okay now that I've crushed your hearts. But so one of the things back from the 13th of this month that I wrote down, the labor is to stay steady while God does the work. How? Howie. And then I have on the 17th, unconditional peace is available, but you must operate in faith, actions of faith, to access the available peace. Intentional, chosen, implemented actions of faith. And sometimes you talk your way out of peace when you just can't hold your tongue. Yeah. So in this discussion about trust, there's some things that are so connected. Belief, faith, trust, hope. Those are like the four corners of this whole thing. They keep everything together. But there's something that happens. There is this fine veil called the future. We can't see through it very good. It's kind of opaque. We can kind of make out a little bit of something on the other side called the future. We can figure out, and we've proven to ourselves that if we eat everything we want, on the other side of that veil, we're going to be fatter. I have proven to myself that if I do everything I want on this side of the veil, I'm going to be depressed on that side of the veil. And we have a great ability to affect what we do beyond that veil, called tomorrow, called the future. It's kind of opaque, and that's what trust is about. Trust is about understanding what God has in front of us by his promises that he lays before us. These promises are great and precious, and you know, you can read them for the first time, you can go through it, and as you go through your life, that belief and that trust in those promises is built by God working in your life. Now, let me talk about my own life here, me. There's a lot of things. Well, when I was a younger man and I was farming, I had some very, very close friends that were farmers too. They were so close that what I would do is I would go to their house about 10 o'clock every morning. I would give them 2 hours of labor and then I'd eat lunch with them. They got to expect it. Bless their hearts. Great friends. But one of them and I worked a lot together. We did a lot of construction. We did farming. We did repairs. All kinds of neat stuff like that. And we had this discussion about faith every day. And we believed that if we had enough faith, we would never have to buy gas for our trucks again. It didn't work out good for us. But that's not what faith is about. Faith is about hearing and obeying, trusting and obeying. I like what Lois did a while back on a Bible study night. She talked about the apostle that was in chains in the prison. And it says that the angel showed up and smote him in the side. It didn't say that he nudged him in the side. It's like, boom. I'm like, that smote thing always got me. It's like, dude, I'm in chains. I mean, did he have to kick him hard to knock him off? You know, what was going on when, I mean, was this guy in the AFL, the Angel Football League? He was the punter, and you know, and he laid one on the guy, and he said, get up and put on your shoes. well, you know, a lot of times in my life, I expect the miracles to happen without me having to do something. And Lois said, God's never going to do for you what you can do for yourself. Owie. So I stood at the altar years ago, and I'm complaining about my financial position. I'm whining to God about my finances. I'm telling him all these things, and I'm going through this in my mind. I'm going like, Lord, I just need to make more money. I need a raise on my job. I need this. I need that. And he goes, Micah, you really don't want another job. I go, you're right, I don't. I just want more money. Can I be honest with you? I just wanted more money. Not only that, I just wanted more money and I didn't want to have to do anything else for it. I just wanted it. I wanted it to come to me. And God made a profound statement there. He says, you need to increase your skills. I was like, owie. That is something that God will always do. He always requires something of you. Faith is not believing it's going to come to you. Faith is the direction and the instructions to get to the end of the matter. It's the faith is him telling you what to do so that you can move down the road to get to the expected end beyond that veil called the future. Cain and Abel, perfect example. I love Cain and Abel's story. I talk about it every time I'm up here because it's so profound. Cain knew exactly what to do. God said, you know, if you did well, you would be blessed for it. Cain never said, yeah, I know. Cain just got mad and killed his brother. Now, let me put it in perspective. It seems as though there was some time, so it was something that was boiling in the boy's heart. He was frustrated at God because God didn't do for him what he wanted. And Cain gave him something. Now, I'm going to prove to you right now that I'm just like Cain. Come here, Cameron. No, I'm messing with you. No, I'm just like Cain because what I did, okay, pastor calls a fast. When pastor, you guys panicked there for a second, didn't you? You just felt that little twinge. I know, I've felt it before. When pastor's called a fast, my brain automatically goes into, what's that mean? Let me translate that for you. What can I get away with? You see, my boys and Wisner figured out that we were having a vegetable fast and that tater tots and ketchup were vegetable. But that's what happens. You find every little loophole you can. My brain automatically starts working, trying to figure out how I can make this less painful, less of a pain, to make it easier so that I can get through this. And I like what pastor does now. It's when you call, it's just, you can have water. It's like, oh. So it kills the finagling, the negotiating. And then there's always the issue when God calls a fast with me, it's like, what can I work God with? You know, if I really do something to suffer real good now, will he let me off the hook for supper? Always negotiating with God. Always trying to figure out. And that, like when I was at the altar and I figured out that God told me that I didn't really want a different job or more of a job. I just wanted more money. I wanted to get an increase for doing the exact same thing I'm doing now. Without increasing effort, without learning a new skill, without doing something different. I just wanted blessed for what I am now. I talk to people all the time on their jobs like, I just don't think I'm getting a fair shake from my boss. Now, I've had a lot of discussions with people about this, and they're like, I really don't think I'm making enough money where I'm at. And so I did a little study. I did a little study on the computer, not necessarily in the Word, but it actually worked out to be first natural and then spiritual. So I did a little study, and I found these things where people of rank, people, high-level people in corporations put together what they wanted to see from people. And what they wanted people to come to them and say, how can I be a benefit to this company? What can I do to be a blessing? What can I do? What responsibilities can you give me that I can run with? I didn't like that, and most of the people I talked to don't like that either. Really, what we want to do is we won't want to put more effort into it. We just want more reward. If it fits, slip it on. It fit for me. I hate to admit it. I hate to admit it. But what happens when you go to God and you ask for something is He's going to give you instructions. Cain did give a sacrifice. He did do it. He did it. He just wanted to fly under the radar and just do enough to get by. And God called him out on it and said, well, you know, that's not what I required, and you know that's not what I required. You know full well, Cain, that's not what I required. And instead of repenting and saying, you know right, Lord, you are right, you are right, you are right, you are right. Instead of doing that, he goes, that's it. Cain was planning on this class being graded on the curve. If everybody did bad, then everybody passed. But that one person in your class, you remember high school, there's always that one smarty that just ruined it for the rest of us. That was what Abel did. He ruined it for Cain, and Cain was resentful for that. Caught him in the field one day, and I don't know what triggered the boy, but he picked up a rock and beat his brother to death. That's serious frustration. Trust is what we do when faith, when belief and faith are engaged. You have belief. You believe that something's going to come to pass. You believe because your faith is built by the Word of God. Faith is your ability to believe God to the point that you obey. I love that part. It is until the point that you obey. It has an obedience in it. Trust and obey, for there's no other way. Trust is what we do when belief and faith are engaged, and we trust in the desired end or the one who holds the desired end. Now, life has this thing about it. Now, I'm closer to the end of life than I am at the beginning, more than likely, because I'm going to be one old senile dude if I hold on and double this thing. I'll just keep that real. So here's what's happened. There has been horrible disappointments in my life. Horrible disappointments. I'm not even going to... things I can't share. Things that are still raw. Things that are wonderful. Things like $10 million lawsuits and spending time in court. I don't like lawyers. Is there one over there? Yeah, I thought there was. There's so many jokes that come to mind. I got to let that go. But, I mean, years in court and, you know, at this point in my life, I'm supposed to be a farmer. That's what I was supposed to be. That didn't work out that way. You know what? God is good. You know, there's things that in my life I've lived long enough that there is a whole pile of things that did not work out the way I thought they should. And you know what? Hear my testimony. God is good. I'm not just saying that. I'm saying that because I've experienced it. He's taken the tragedies of life and He's grown me to something that I never thought I'd be. I'm not where I want to be, you know, financially. I'm not where I wanted to be professionally. I'm not where I thought I would be professionally. And what's that got to do with it? Nothing. Because God had a different path. Now, the interesting thing about that is the Bible talks of the saints that, oh, don't take her. She wants to be in the front row. One of the greatest things in life is children, and one of the hardest things in life is children. Amen. Yeah, said the parents. And, oh, I'm going to give you, my boys are old now, older than me. I'm going to give you great wisdom here. This is free, no charge. It doesn't get easier. It gets different. Every phase of life is different and wonderful and difficult and a challenge. And it has to be filled with trust that God's in control. I don't know how people do it that don't have God. I do not know how they do it. As a matter of fact, I've done funerals with people when the people didn't have any Jesus at all. Man, they're tragic. I've done funerals where they're young people OD'd with kids. And I've watched their friends come to the door and not have the courage to come in the door where the body is until they go out to the car and get high. That's rough. That's rough. But we got Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. So let's go through some trust scriptures here. Let's go to it's called Proverbs, not Preverbs. Proverbs 3 and 5. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Don't lean on your own understanding, because if you lean on your own understanding, you will be the most pathetic of all. You will be, your own understanding says, I can do whatever feels good in the moment. Okay, let's back up a little bit to the veil of the future. Everything you do, and at my age, I'm realizing this more than ever, I've got two artificial hips, as you all know, and they are a result of what I did way back then. Now, I thank God for them, because that's the only inheritance my kids are getting. But, you know, I did things in my youth that really led into two pieces of titanium in my body. Thank God for them. But I didn't see beyond that veil into the future. You're always negotiating with who you are in the future. Always negotiating with who you are in the future. You're always working out and making a deposit or a withdrawal from your future self. Always. And God is always working. Now, we got this veil of tomorrow, and we can kind of see a little bit unto death. But you know, when you come here and you're laying up here, and pastor's up here talking, well, and you're not laying there, but your body's laying there. You know, the reality is that kind of is a finality. I don't know how to say that. It's kind of like the end. End-ish. End-like. We have the promises of God for what's on the other side, but still, you know, that body looked kind of real there. It kind of hit up against that. You know, and when your parents die, you get this revelation. Well, I'm next. You know, kind of in the thing. I talk to people all the time. People don't want to talk about that stuff. But the reality is, you start feeling, oh, wait a second. that day's getting closer for me. And then when you really, really have to deal with it. Ooh. I told Pastor, I'm not afraid of dying, and I'm not. I am very nervous about how bumpy the exit ramp might be. Just to be real. But as we go through life, I remember in my 30s, I was scared to death of dying. Scared to death. Matter of fact, I had panic attacks about dying. In my 30s, mid-40s, and then as I got older and my body got worn down a little bit and God got a little stronger within me, it's like, oh, okay, you come to a conclusion. The people that rely on you when you're younger, they're on their own. It's a little easier to embrace it. It's a natural part. So if you're afraid of dying right now, don't worry about it. Just keep living life. God has a way of preparing you for what's beyond the veil. But it can be a booger. But if you lean on your own understanding, that's what happens in that funeral that I'm doing, those funerals that I do for people that are OD'd, and I see their friends and their family and their acquaintances, and they come to the door and they can't come in until they go get high out in their car. Or they come in and they're so distraught and they leave behind children and spouses and people that love them. Because they weren't able to see beyond the immediate gratification of their life. Now, I'm also going to tell you this. To grow in God or any aspect of life is going to take some discomfort. If you want to grow muscles, you got to work against resistance. You got to put effort into it. You got to make time for it. You got to eat right. You got to work out. You got to make time. You have to do these things. It's the same way with Jesus. If you want to grow in God, there's going to, look, the Bible says you will have tribulations. You will. Whether you believe or don't believe, you're going to have tribulations. Boy, that'll get them in the door. The gospel, the good news is that Jesus has overcome those. Jesus had tribulations. Jesus had the ultimate in tribulations. What happened to him? He lived a perfect life. You would think, so, in our mindset, in our reasoning, in our own understanding, we think, if you do right, you're going to get good stuff. Jesus did right and got buggered up. Jesus did right. He lived a perfect life. He had people beside him and around him that believed in him and believed on him, and they didn't get it right till after he was dead. He's getting ready to go to the cross. This always blows me away. He's getting ready to go to the cross. He knows he's going to die. He's told his boys, he says, yeah, Lord, boys, we're going to town. I'm going to get killed. And they're like, hey, you know, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, can I sit on your right side? This is what he went through. He knows what's before him. And his boys that are his boys that are the closest people in the world to him, they're like negotiating with him. And he holds a Bible study. As a matter of fact, I think it's in Mark. There's like five chapters of his teaching between when he started the Passover meal until he went to Gethsemane to pray. He lays out all kinds of Bible. If I'm getting ready to die, I'm going to be sitting here whining to y'all. I'm going to have Davey make me some ribs. I'm going to have Evelyn in my arms. I'm going to be chilling out, and I'm going to be whining the whole time. And you guys come in and complain about anything. I was like, you guys need to quit because I'm going to die. And you guys just need to stop. Come on, let's be real. That's exactly how it would work. But Jesus was the person that least deserved that got the worst. And he learned obedience through what he was pressed with, through his suffering. And that's what we get to do. We get to tell you these tribulations of life are going to come at us. Now, there's some things on that veil of the future that we can help ourselves avoid down the road. We can help ourselves and our future self do better. But there's some things on the other side that's going to come at you that you don't know, like a call to do Bible study on Wednesday morning. Those things are going to happen. But you see, once again, I got the call for Bible study, but I trust in God that he will provide the word that is needed. I don't have to fret about it. I did. I put effort into it. I studied. I went into deep meditation. I spent extra time with the Lord today to get to where we needed to be. But I trusted in him to the point I was able to say yes. I was able to trust and obey. Next scripture, Romans 8:28. And we know, see, this one here, this scripture came alive for me when I wrote, when Pastor explained to us that the promises were to Jesus. This all made more sense than I ever knew how. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to love God, to them who they are called according to his purpose. You see, we all want to, and I did for years, say, it all works for my good. No, it works to the good of them that love the Lord. To the good. It's for the good of the body. It's for the good of everybody. You see, there's some guys in the Old Testament that said in Hebrews, it talks about in the faith chapter, these people went down and were persecuted, and they were persecuted and not for themselves, or they had a word from God, not necessarily for their time, but for us that live now, that we can have that word deposited to us that we can obey and trust and believe God in the future. Now, I'm not sure I want to really be one of those people that get to go through things for the now, for, you know, a few generations down the road. I'll go through some things for my kids. I'll go through a few things for my grandkids. But beyond that, y'all on your own. But it works for the good of the body. Now, see if I can develop a real quick concept here for you of how awesome God is. I'll try to put this together. I hope, hang with me. Hang with me. Wake, shake yourself. Wake up. God is so amazing that he takes all you people's free will at one time and allows you to make decisions. Some decisions are good, some not so great, some are really bad. Sometimes we sin and we get to repent and we get to move on. But at any moment in time, God has scoped out a whole future of how this would go at that moment in time with the decisions we've made. You follow me? For a billion people on the earth, he does that all at once, and then one of us makes a different decision, and he automatically recalculates the whole thing. Continually. Now we got all, just that for the people in here would be a trip. And he does that so that he can bring his will on earth. He works with people and countries and massages people's minds. He gives strength and courage. He brings word. He brings encouragement to our hearts. You know, the biggest thing that happens when you get saved is God floods you with this understanding of who he is. And then he'll do it again. And then he'll do it again. And then according to what you feed your spirit man will rise up. Sometimes, I've gone through seasons when my spirit man looked like he was starving to death. You know, looked like those monks that starved themselves to death, just all frail and no faith, not ability to get up, can't do nothing for himself. That's what my spirit man looked like because I was starving the dude to death. He was on a fast, but he wasn't getting no stronger. And there's times when God has said, let me put it like this. There's been times when I've gone through things that have been so difficult that you go to the Word and you read and said, well, I can't get nothing out of it. I'm sure some of you have been there. I just don't understand nothing. And God made it really plain to me. He says, you don't have to understand anything. In those moments, just read it. And I'd go and I'd look out into the outside, or I'd go outside and I'd read it out loud until my spirit man was filled up, until he became strong enough to stand up, and then he became strong enough to believe, and then he became strong enough to encourage myself. The spirit man needs that. That's why I come to Bible study. I don't miss Bible study if I'm in town. I don't do it. You know why? Because I need it. I'm better with it. I don't like me without it. I don't like me without Bible study. I don't like me if I miss church. I don't like me that way. I'm not a very good guy. No amens, that's good. I'm just checking. Jeremiah 17 and 7, please. Blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. The Lord is his hope. Blessed is the man that trusts in the Lord. He trusts in God because God has said he's going to do this. He's shown you through action that he'll do it. And you trust that your future will be this way because he said so. You trust. You trust in God. Psalms 37, 4 and 5. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Man, have I messed that one up. He said, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. 5. Commit your ways unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Now, I always feel like I needed to explain this a little bit. God says you commit your ways to the Lord. You trust in him. You trust in him, and he will place desires in your heart. He's not going to do something that's going to oppose him. He is going to work with you and massage you to put you in a power position. A power position. A lot of times, the things that's happened to me that haven't been so great was power positioning of God to get me where he wanted me to be. And you commit your ways to him and you trust in him, he'll bring those desires that he's placed in your heart to pass. I always thought, well, yeah, you know, a desire of my heart. Look, and I always negotiate with God. I'm going to share my deepest, don't tell anybody. This is us. I love planes, airplanes, love airplanes, loved them forever, love airplanes. Can't say it enough. So I always wanted to have a private jet for the body. You know, pastor needs to go see mama. Hour down the airway. Pop in, pop out. Yeah. You know, and I always deal with God like, you know, I'll be such a blessing to the church with my plane. But then I come in and I'm cleaning up and I find chicken wings under the chairs that y'all were sitting in. I'm like, what in the world? I don't want that on my plane, nuts. I have found chicken wings under the seat. But that's another story for another time. Another time. Yeah. But God will bring to pass as you trust him, as you commit your ways to him. He'll bring to pass the desires in your heart that he placed there. That's a wonderful thing. Give me Isaiah 26 and 3. Thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. And, you know, we get this part, but the because he trusts in God. So, well, can I be honest with y'all? I didn't really catch that last part all very, very good until just today. Isn't that the way it works? He will keep you in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him because he trusts in him. Woo! Okay, Psalm 91 and 2. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. Now, the thing I like about this one is I will say of the Lord. Out of your mouth is power. Saying it is power. He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, and I will trust in him. And then Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you. This is God talking to you. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, said the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. That's something to trust in. That's something to hold on to. That's something to believe in. trusting in God. I think I'm there. I am. To the desired end. Yep. That's it. Trust is what we do when belief and faith are engaged. Trust in a desired end or the one who holds that desired end. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you, Lord God. I stand here, Lord, and I trust you to give to your people exactly what they need, that they may go into the veil of the future, not afraid and knowing what they need to do now for what's on the other side of this life and the life to come. Father, talk to your people. Encourage their hearts with your word and engage yourself in their life, Lord God, that they may trust you in all ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys.